for forest design, on behalf of forest design. We started to work with forest design as part of the FPCAP activity related to the use of Copernicus satellite data for forest monitoring or forest management activities. This started the beginning of the year, and as part of this activity, we have a number of sites being observed in situ by forest design, and for each of these sites they are producing a lot of very detailed information related to the forest, and the plan is to show different methods of correlating this in situ information with satellite data for deriving further products or information that is going to or can be used by the forest managers in daily activities. Well, I don't want to go more into the details. Mihai will show us not only information about this activity that we are running together, but also about some other aspects related to the use of combination of satellite and in situ observations for forestry. So Mihai, you have the floor, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you for inviting me to this very nice workshop organized by Romanian Space Agency. So now that we had so many nice talks about how you see the forest from space, so from top down, I want to change a little bit that perspective and to look to the forest from bottom up. Well, because this is the most familiar perspective of the foresters. So we're usually going to the forest and we estimate and we characterize the forest from that perspective. So that's why we're focusing on the terrestrial laser scanner as a remote sensing tool, and how we can link those data with the Copernicus data and to deliver to the foresters. So before I start my presentation, I want to give you a little bit of context. Well, for sure, this is a national context in Romanian forestry, but I think it's more a global one. And I want to ask the question, how safe is forestry in a subjective system? And today we are dealing with a lot of debates regarding the data about the forest, how accurate they are, how objective or subjective they are. And usually we finish up doing this, like these two guys looking on different sides of the problem and seeing different things. And this subjective system in forestry, it's something that we foresters we maintained. Well, we need to talk now about changing the paradigm in forestry. And I have this very nice illustration from Müller about the step forward that we need to go to the virtual forest. This is the new concept that we need to move further. And what is nice is, of course, in the past and even today, we are still working with modeling, simulation, and virtual forest. But the way how we gather the data is different. In the manual inventory, we do the inventory and we pop up directly to the model, and we have the estimation, the virtual forest. Well, with remote sensing, we can measure more things that they are skipped or uniformized mean average in the manual inventory, because in here we have tree data, stand data, topography, infrastructure, a lot of things that are influencing our data. And yeah, of course, I took this sentence, ignorance is bliss. So if you don't know things about the stuff in here, you don't matter. So you say my model is perfect. But the forests, we know for sure that they're not perfect. They are very diverse and very complex. And having this in mind, my talk will focus on four major, let's say, group of questions. The first of all, we are going to start bottom up. So first of all, how accurate is terrestrial forest terrestrial laser scanning in the forest, in forestry? Is it enough, accurate enough for the foresters? It's accurate enough for these forest complex ecosystems. The second, okay, once we get those million and billions of points and points cloud, how we translate those information to the standing volume, to the thing that the foresters needs, you know, the foresters, the owners, the forest managers, and even the society. So how we do that, how we translate it from that. The third big question, okay, I have data which are on terrestrial point of view, but can I connect it this with the aerial perspective, with the Earth observation perspectives, to produce reliable remote sensing products? Can we go to the next level? Plot level, district level, county level, regional level? And of course, the last question, and this will be open for everybody in the Q&A. We need for sure precise forests in Romania, and this is a worldwide concept that is growing. How do we change the paradigm in the forestry in Romania and worldwide? So, starting with the TLS in the forest, well, if you talk about TLS 5 years ago, you are talking about a very big machine, 40 kilos, carrying out with a troller. And doing that in the forest would be like, oh my God, this is very hard. But now technology is growing fast, as well as the computational power. And we do have mobile scanners. And with the trade-off in the accuracy, you can actually scan a complex system, forest system, because yeah, all the trees are not staying on the right position. And here's an example that for a 3,000 square meter plot, it took 7 minutes to scan it and 20 minutes to produce the point cloud. And well, producing the valid 3D reality of a forest pilot is less than one hour. This is a circular plot. And yeah, here we are. We are in this technological peak and computational power that we can cover large areas. So this is an example. You can go up to, in 4 hours, you can scan 10 hectares, depending on, okay, how hard is the field, the terrain, the slope, and so on. So we can cover quite large areas. And if you think about Romanian forestry, 10 hectares it's an average area of a subcompartment. So we can actually extrapolate these, that you can say that we can do the TLS monitoring at subcompartment level. And of course, when we start this, we enter into the partnership with the Romanian Space Agency, like you were saying, trying to link Copernicus Sentinel data and services into forest management process. And we build a network of 10 plots of 1 hectare in the forest, where we scan everything and we took all the data, and mostly to see how reliable are the data driven from the point clouds, from the scanner. And with the Romanian Space Agency, we do have one activity, but we do have many activities with other stakeholders in the industry, and now we have more than 500 plots at the Romania level. So we do have the consistent data that we scan. And give you the answer, how reliable is TLS? Here is an example of 3 plots that we scanned and we measured manually, DBH and height, using the top technology, like the tape and the vertex logger, and to see, okay, how accurate, how reliable are the data from TLS. And well, these are the results in here for diameter, height, and volume. These are the Bland-Altman we do it like this, the Blandalman limit of agreement, you can see that on the DBH and high they are. In India, 95% limit of agreement. Again, comparing the model between the classical and the virtual measurements from the point cloud. Only the volume, it has a slight difference because we use different way how to calculate the volume from 3D model and of course from our yield table. But as you can see in here, the data are reliable. They are maintaining the same patterns like in the classical measurements, both in the diameter and height, with slight some underestimation on the height, on the smaller lower heights, and the volume which is quite nicely developing on a very close model. But not only us we are saying this. We recently went to Silvi Laser conference, and in here Professor Hippe, something like this, I'm not good, sorry about my Finnish. So he said on some plots in Finland, he compared the mobile laser scanners with the field measurements, and in some cases the mobile scanners actually they got a lower error than the field measurements, which is quite nice to see. And of course in the research world we can see a lot of comparisons like this one. So this is proving that the TLS and the mobile TLS, they are reliable enough for forestry. They are comparable with the field measurements that people are doing now. Okay, but how we translate the point cloud we take from the TLS to the foresters? Because the foresters, they don't want to see the point clouds. they want to see the real data. They want to see the data they are interested in. They want to see, okay, what is the standing volume there? Okay, what is the basal area? And the presenter before me, they were saying this, that these are the products that the foresters, they want more than change detection product, which is well good, but not enough for management. And Virsilv, it's more than a service. It's a way of doing things. So it's combining the scanning, the processing, and the analysis, because in the end you need reliable data, and this is the word for today: reliability of the terrestrial perspective of remote sensing. And the processing, Virsilv is taking the point clouds and it's extracting the data and giving them into an easy to use API. Yeah, like if you want to enter it into a GIS system, or even more than that, only a simple number, because sometimes in forestry, an accurate data, put it in a easy way to read, is more important than having billions of point clouds. And just a short insight on how the Virsilv forest works. So from the forest to the AI processing, first of all, we have the field work. And this is my colleague Bogdan. When you are doing the scanning, it is important to get correct point clouds and accurate point clouds. So you need to see what are the capacity, what is the capacity of the scanner in order to produce continuous point clouds and to create good data. And yeah, this is a very important step when using TLS, because in many situations, if in complex forests, for instance, in the tripod scanners, we do have problems with that, because we have a lot of obstructions. With the mobile scanners, we don't. Of course, there is a trade-off. And after that, after you have this massive point cloud, the Virsilv is taking everything automatically. So in terms of processing, it's doing the it has its own AI, its own adaptive algorithm that is segmenting each type of forest irrespective of what we have in there. And based on that, we can have 3x3 point clouds, and from there the system is analyzing and taking the stem volume, the taper function, the branches volumes, and all this information about the architecture of each tree. So if you remember when we're talking about what is the virtual forest model, well, this is the first step, having very accurate data and unique data at tree level. And after that, yeah, we need to translate the information into a final digital map. So getting all the map, all those tree data together into a stand level information and adding more information on that, like information that it is needed for the species determination, like images from the site to for getting the colors and all other aspects that you cannot take it from a 3D point cloud. And this is an API that can be easily implemented into own system for forest managers or owners or I don't know, active watch NGOs and so on. So this is the data in this format that it is translating billions of points into a smaller quantity and more understandable quantity of data. But sometimes not even this is it's enough for a forester, because in the end the forester want this information at stand level. And this is an example of two plots that we are producing this automatically, and we have different views of the forest, like the canopy level view, we have the terrain level view, that we do have the dead trees lying on the soil. We do have combined with other tools that we have the growth and the distribution per species, and we do have the histograms of diameter, height, and all this kind of information that for foresters they are really in hand. And going back to the virtual forest perspective, with a manual inventory, well, you can do this, but it's taking a lot of time. And that's why many situations are saying, okay, this is impossible to do. Well, now the technology is doing that, and these informations are really good and reliable for the forest management, because in the end, this is what I want. I want to see what is the influence of forest harvesting in a forest. Well, I do a before and after scanning, and I do what I see objectively what is happening, and not subjective or putting everything in a piece of paper like we usually see in the business as usual systems now. And having this data, well, they are at plot level or a subcompartment level, and we think about, okay, can we do more? Can we live up to the needs of the society now, that they want more than a compartment level, they want the forest level, the regional level, and so on. Okay, so the answer is linking to the satellites, or linking the satellite data, Earth observation data, for the foresters and for the society. And we already seen that there are a lot of developments in here. There are a lot of platforms that are doing that. And what we want to show here, it's only from research point of view, we have developed a machine learning algorithm implemented into a JavaScript code in Google Earth Engine, and based on the Copernicus data on Sentinel-2 data, we use a supervised random forest machine learning algorithm, and we execute it there. But the most important aspect of this is the field data. So we integrated the TLS data as forest inventory plots into the machine learning algorithm. And what we have learned from this is the more accurate and more diverse data you have in the machine learning process, you'll get better results. And this is something that we agree for sure everywhere in the research and in the production too. And in here we model the forest age, basal area, diameter, height, number of trees, and the volume at pixel level. And as I said, the algorithms can be implemented. They are already implemented in many solutions in here. And as an example, here is an extrapolated model at Romania level. like we've seen in the TEP platform. So no news in here that we can get at pixel level using open source free available data, satellite data, Earth observation data from Copernicus to get what we need. And if we go even more on that, we can see in here the results at district level, right? Like for a forest district or a forest engineer who wants to see what is the evolution in their subcompartments. Of course, we can do that. We can overlap the data and we can see what is, the age distribution maybe is not that important, but we can have the standing volume, which is more important expressed as cubic meter per hectare. And we can see some of the subcompartments. If we do have dynamics in here, like forest harvesting is happening, I can see the dynamics inside the subcompartment, which is not possible now in a forest management plan, because this is done updated annually and recalculated at every 10 years. So yeah, we can do this based on the data entry, which are really important to extrapolate. Yeah, this is the density as a number of trees per hectare and the basal area that we extrapolated. So these data, they work both on district level, but they can go on regional level or country level for sure. And the accuracy of them, it's influenced by these factors of data entry and the way how the algorithm is doing that. I'm going on the last question. And this is actually the most important one. So we do have tools, we do have developments. We know for sure that this is working and this can be implemented. And we need to say the word. We need precise forestry. Now the forests are more than timber, and they have a lot of ecosystem services that society is putting a price on. And for getting them as accurate as we can, we need precise forestry. And yeah, I took the liberty to take another very nice schematics made by Mueller, saying the Internet of Trees and Services, you know, an acronym from IoT, Internet of Things. What is nice is this is what the precise forestry is. You know, everything gets on different levels, on starting on the forest enterprise with the planning. You know, we need the tree data, stand level. We need all the information about the machine data, the productivity data, and everything is connected to the virtual forest and to the log data, tree by tree, log by log, in different areas. And just to put it in the context, in the Romanian context, with the Sumal, now we are here. We only have this, the transport. This is only at the end. If we control this one, it is a waste of time, because we need to control the entire chain. And we need to start from the forest and not from here. Because in here, this is the main, the basis line, the baseline that we need to start with. And we do have the technology to do that. We can cover large areas. This can be done at forest level and so on. But changing the paradigm from the subjective to objective thinking in forestry comes with investments, stability. And when I say stability, entire stability, we are the country who changed the forest code so many times that you cannot count it on your one hand. And investments, of course, in education. And as key messages to all the four groups of questions regarding the TLS in the forest. TLS is now fast and accurate, suitable for forestry for sure. The mobile TLS are reliable for complex ecosystems, bringing more objective data than the classical approach. This is one. Two, VirSilv, it's a tool that it's translating the point cloud into data that foresters need. from remote sensing to foresters speaking in common forestry language. This is the common forestry language, and this applies not only in Romania, it applies everywhere. We know this because we work in many countries that are going to the same common forestry language. Third one, linking satellites to field data. Fusing TLS, terrestrial and aerial perspective is the key for reliable remote sensing products in remote sensing. And yeah, this is the case here. And of course, the last one regarding the precise forestry in Romania, changing the paradigm in forestry comes with investments, stability and education. And when I say education, goes on both ways of the problems on the foresters and the society too. And instead of thank you, I just want to underline that TLS and Earth observation data are not the absolute answer, but together with the other are the part of the solution for forestry. Thank you.